Welcome back to our Windows Azure Pack Infrastructure as a Service Jumpstart. This is the fourth module where we're going to really be focusing on delivering self-service. I'm Simon Perryman, Senior Technical Evangelist, and I'm joined by Vaibhava here, who is one of our experts around delivering that self-service model. So let's take a quick look at where we are in our day. So far, we've really kind of introduced the key concepts of Windows Azure Pack. We've installed it, and then we've integrated it with our Fabric through Virtual Machine Manager. We're now going to kind of take this next step and start preparing us to be able to offer that self-service. But Vaibhava, why don't you go ahead and introduce yourself?
Hi, Simon. My name is Vaibhava Ramadas, and I'm a program manager on the Windows Azure Pack team. My primary areas so far have been configuration, usage, database as a service, and a couple of service administrative capability. So today, I'm going to put on my service admin hat, and I'm going to really focus on being a service administrator in WAP with Simon, and we're going to get joined by John later.
Great.
In the session.
So let's walk us through the agenda then.
Wonderful. So today we're going to talk a little bit about Azure technology. We're going to talk about how Azure Stack actually works, and then jump into service administrative concepts within WAP, and then do the deep dive on what the IaaS service administrative experience actually is in WAP. So let's keep going through this. So Azure. So if you look at Azure Stack today, you really have the Windows Azure Fabric, which sits at the bottom. You have a set of services that Azure enables, which is like websites, VMs, service bus databases. And on top of that, you have the APIs and the portal UX that the customers interact with. And we have taken this Windows Azure experience or Microsoft Azure experience, and we've ported that to run on what we call as the on-premises fabric. So this is really Windows Server and System Center that offers the on-premises fabric for us. And on top of this, we have the services that are consistent with Azure, as well as the portal and the API layers for that consistent end user experience. Now, alongside this, what we also add is the service administrative capability. And so we add the admin portal as well as admin APIs. And behind the scenes, it allows the service administrator to do things like plans, manage their services, manage how they bundle up their services. They could do usage on their tenant subscriptions. They could do automation capability that allows them to trigger automation sequences behind the scenes, as well as kind of maintain that relationship with the end tenant users as well and do user management. And so if you look at this, this is really the Azure Pack collection and what we're going to be doing the deeper dive today.
Now, generally, like, we think of two consumers in the data center. We think of our self-service user, the end user, and then the infrastructure administrator. Where exactly does that service admin fit in?
So that's a great question. So the service administrator really sits in between these two types of users. So you have like the two ends of the spectrum, the fabric administrator who maintains the infrastructure in the data center, thinks about hosts and networks and things like that, deeply technical. And then you have the self-service user who's really thinking mostly about their application. They're trying to get VMs, websites, or databases that really is going to help develop their application. And they want a simple, lightweight experience to just go and consume one of those resources. The service administrator spends a lot of time thinking about that end user, the star of the show, but spends time bundling the services, setting the right prices, setting the right advertisements and capabilities that allow them to enable that right and perfect end user experience for the self-service user.
So what are the key areas of focus that the server admin has?
The key areas are really about, one, they think about their tenants all the time. They think about how to attract users, how to retain them in the system, how to keep giving them new sets of services that they can use every day and come and acquire every day. They want to be able to offer compelling value within their services. So they want to be able to set the right kind of prices as well as the right kind of quotas that get people into the system and help them retain them in the system. The next piece is, once you have these users, you want to learn how to set up the right billing for them, as well as the right capacity management. What that is you have a certain capacity in your infrastructure. When do you know when to buy more? You want to observe how much the tenants are actually using in the system and plan your capacity based on that. And the last piece is about how do you efficiently do this with not necessarily a large set of people, with a small team that understand and can use the system. I'm going to be talking more about the first couple of points later in this deck, and then John will talk more about the last piece.
Great. So let's go through some of these service admin concepts as well in a little more detail. So what are kind of the key areas that we want to break it down to?
So the key things that we're going to be talking about today is that end user, the self-service user or the tenant, the resource provider, which is the service that sits underneath on top of that fabric, which enables these different services like VMs, websites, et cetera, and then plans. So how do you bundle those services up, add-ons, and then subscriptions. And subscriptions is really what the end user sees or self-service user sees when they think about how much capacity they have in the system and how much they're getting charged for these different capabilities.
So let's start with plans. First, could you define what exactly is a plan?
Great, absolutely. A plan is really something that brings together these sets of services or resource providers. So what is a resource provider? A resource provider is really a REST-based interface that offers up a particular type of resource. It could be a VM or a website or a database. And what a plan really does is it just allows you to bundle these services up into the ones that your tenants want to use, as well as sets up the right kind of quotas on them. So they really represent what we call as a tier of service. So within WAP, a service administrator is able to come in and create and manage these bundles of services. And what they do is they choose either all or a subset of these services as part of creating that bundle, which is the plan. The one additional thing here is that if you, as part of your system, want to enable a custom resource provider to be a part of the system, then that as long as you snap to the right APIs, that custom RP is going to show up like any other out-of-box RP that's available in the system. We have some details which you guys can reference later when you look through this deck. The next piece is add-ons. So an add-on is something that's really similar to a plan. If you look at the experience, it's actually extremely similar. But what an add-on really is it allows you to have additive capacity on top of what you got from your plan. So when the tenants come in and they get a plan, they get a subscription, they get access to a certain set of services and some base quota, and now the add-on allows you to add on to those base quota items. A very simple example is my initial plans gives me access to 10 VMs. My add-on might give me access to 2 more VMs as part of my system. And so the service administrative experience to create an add-on is extremely similar to what it is for a plan. You can create and manage an add-on in WAP, and you can add a subset of the services that are available in the system as part of your add-on. Next, we have the concept of linking of a plan and add-on. So once the service administrator has built out what we call a plan, they will go build out the add-on objects, and now they have to link them to each other. What this really means is when, as a tenant, I come and I purchase a particular plan, I get access to a certain set of resources, and now based on what the service administrator has made available to me, I can now go and purchase a particular set of add-ons that are available in the system. And now this is enabled by the service administrator actually linking these up. And now if I have plan one and I want to link my particular add-on, I can choose an add-on which has a service which is a part of the plan itself. And so add-on one and add-on two have VMs and websites which are related to the plan one services, and so I can tie them in, while add-on three has the service MySQL in it, but we cannot use that as part of plan one. The same goes for plan two, the same example. We essentially can add-on two and three, but not add-on one as part of this linking process. Okay. Next, I was going to jump into a demo environment and show you exactly how this looks.
Great. So while you switch over there, I want to remind people, if you could please answer the poll question. We posted a new one at the start of this module asking, which cloud provider do you primarily use? Is that Microsoft Azure, VMware's vCloud Hybrid Service, AWS, Amazon Web Services, none or another? So if you could please minimize from the full screen view, there's still over 500 of you out there that haven't answered the poll question. You ready for the demo?
Yes, absolutely. So let's jump into the environment. So this is an environment that has a lot of services that are plugged in to the WAP infrastructure. If you look at this, this is the administrative console. And so this looks very similar to the Azure core framework as well. But the difference, the key difference here is that I am seeing every single service that has been plugged in to the WAP infrastructure, and which is different than the tenant experience where you see only a subset of the services that are part of your subscription. This service administrative capability allows me to manage these different clouds that provide the different resources in the system, much like the website cloud, VM clouds, SQL, MySQL servers. You can also have access to automation and plans and user accounts. Now, we're going to do a deeper dive into plans, so let me go ahead and create a new plan. So, well, let's call this the MEA Jumpstart Plan. Okay. So I'm going to go ahead, create this, and add some of the out-of-box services that are available in my WAP experience. So I add this, and then I start creating my plan. So this is really going ahead and creating an instance of a plan within the WAP API and infrastructure layers. So now this is actually giving me a little bit of a warning. It's saying not configured, right? So don't be alarmed by the red bang. It really just means that there's one extra step to be done. What's happening here is it tells you very clearly one or more services are not yet configured. So you can go back down and it tells you which service this is. This is because some of our services can auto-configure themselves, but some of them need certain additional bits of data that need to be configured before this can go live. And so let's drill into this. And so the VMM clouds tells me that I need to actually pick the VMM provider as well as the actual cloud that I'm going to be adding to my plan. And as long as this basic information is added, I can now go ahead and save this plan. What this also allows me to do is it has a set of basic quota that's available in the system. I can change these and just make this say a number like 10, or I can say use all available.
Now, within Virtual Machine Manager, that interface allows you to also specify some capacity controls for a cloud. It looks like this does the same thing. What's kind of the relationship between these two capacity planning tools?
Okay. And so, in general, what happens is this is actually a view that is made available by VMM through SPF as well. So, that data that that lives in VMM actually shows all the way up into the WAP interface.
Excellent. So we're consistent here in the...
Right. So, when you apply controls here, it actually goes all the way down to VMM as well. Now, John, later in this segment, will actually drill into what each of these things are and all the different combinations that you can make as part of this configuration. So I'm going to go ahead and hit save. And then I'm done. I come back. I don't see any more warnings. But what I do see is I see a notification that says the plan is private. This essentially means that the only way for me to sign up a tenant to this plan is to do it from the service administrative console. And I cannot do this I cannot sign myself up as a tenant. And so what I'm going to do here is I'm going to go ahead and make that public. So we can actually view that from the tenant console as well. The next step in this sequence is I'm going to go create an add-on. So I'm going to say MVA Jumpstart add-on. Here, I want to choose either all or a subset of the services that were in the plan. So I'm going to go ahead and pick virtual machines, hit OK. And here, this will now tell me that I need to go and further configure this. So it says add-on is not configured. So I go ahead and I say I want to choose this particular VMM provider and cloud. And now you'll also notice that I do not come with a default set of quota here. I actually need to work bottom up and choose exactly the additional capacity that I want to add into the system. So I'm going to add 10 as my additional capacity on top of 100 VMs. I'm going to hit save and let's go back. This add-on is now configured, but similar to a plan, the add-on needs to be made public as well, which means that the tenant user will be actually able to see this when they are signing up. So once they get that subscription through the plan, they can now use this interface to add an add-on to their system. Okay, so one last step that needs to be done is the linking that was shown in the slide. So I'm going to link to a plan. And the plan, I'm going to link to the plan that I just created, which is the MVAJS plan. And that linking was successful, so woohoo. So I'm going to use this in the tenant demo as well. So we can switch back to the slides.
Okay, great. So I think the next thing you were going to talk about is the subscription tenant. Could you just first give us an overview? What exactly is that?
Absolutely. And so we kind of looked at everything from the service administrative lens so far. And so the next lens is to actually act like a tenant and see what the system looks like and how the system interacts with you. And so what we're going to do is understand some key concepts. So what is a tenant? A tenant is really a person who comes into the system. He's a user in the system who comes in and has an identity as part of an identity provider that is plugged into the system. So examples of identity providers, you have the out-of-box capability with ASP.NET. But when you're going to production, you can use AD or some other identity provider that you're already using in production. And ADFS, as we've seen earlier today, allows you to federate through these different identity providers. The next piece of the puzzle is the subscription itself. The subscription is actually a very great, unique handle that identifies capabilities in the system. What this really does is it allows the resource providers to understand how much quota limits need to be associated with a particular tenant, as well as for a provider, it allows a billing handle that he can use to charge against for usage that has been done against the different VMs or websites or databases. And so now that we know those key concepts, let's look at what that flow looks like. And so the tenant authenticates first with the identity system. Next up, they go and subscribe to a plan. This at the back end generates a subscription for them. And what happens is that triggers a very important capability. What that triggers is the quota fan out that goes to the different RPs. What this really is that the resource provider until this point doesn't know anything about the tenant. It doesn't know about quotas, it doesn't know about plans or add-ons or anything. But what it really understands is subscription and quotas against that subscription, and that's all it understands. And whether it's a plan or add-on, it all gets translated to subscription and quota, and that's it. So now the RPs come to know that this tenant is active in the system and that this is a subscription they're going to be using against their resources. And this is available to go out to your custom RPs as well. So if you plug in a custom RP, it's going to go out and fan out quota limits to the custom RP as well. Next up, the add-on purchase capability. This is actually extremely similar to the plan purchase capability as well. Once the person is in the system and has a plan and a subscription, they can now acquire an add-on, and this add-on updates the subscription. It doesn't generate a new one, but it updates the subscription to have additive quota, and this additive quota gets fanned out to the different resource providers as well. Okay. We've talked about the different sets of objects as part of the session so far. We've talked about plans, add-ons, subscriptions, and tenants. I'm going to quickly show you how these things relate to each other. The plans and add-ons first as part of the system, once they're created, they're linked to each other like we saw in the demo. And this is really a many-to-many relationship. You can have separate objects for plans and add-ons, and you can link them up so that one plan relates to one or multiple add-ons, as well as one add-on relates to one or more plans. And so once this is available as part of the service administrative experience, the tenant can come purchase a plan. And when they purchase a plan, the next step is that it generates a subscription. So that's where the subscription object comes into picture. The next piece is that the tenant can acquire an add-on, and this updates a subscription and doesn't generate a new object. The one additional capability here is that if you do not want your tenants to be signing up by themselves, you can absolutely have the administrator be the one who's maintaining all the tenant capabilities in the system. So the administrator can manage tenants in the identity system, they can subscribe on behalf of the tenant, as well as everything behind the scenes will act exactly the same. It's just that once now the tenant comes to comes with their identity into the system, they will automatically see a set of services and a set of quota that has been already allocated to them by the service administrator.
Great. Well, I think you got another demo coming up, is that right?
Yes.
So as you switch over, I'll just give a quick summary of our last poll. So we asked you guys, which cloud provider do you primarily use? About 40% of you use Microsoft Azure, which is great. So we see kind of a lot of Microsoft loyal people here, staying within that Microsoft stack, getting the benefits of, you know, the on-premise public cloud and get that hybrid cloud solution. We see about 30% of you not using any cloud provider, and then the rest are kind of mixed, about 5 to 10% from AWS, a local service provider, or the VMware vCloud hybrid service. So a bit of a range here, but a lot of focus on Azure. Are we ready for the demo?
Absolutely. So we're going to switch over and see everything from the tenant lens now. And so if you look at this, this is slightly different. We have a sign-up page for the tenant. And so since we made our plans and add-ons public, the tenants can now come and actually sign up. This is an experience that's enabled out of box by our ASP.NET membership provider. Depending on the identity provider you use in your system, this page could look completely different, much like an AD page. And so what I can do here is I can sign up. I'm going to sign up as a simple identity, and I'm setting up my super secret password. And now I'm actually in the system. Since this is using ASP.NET, it actually allows me to generate a not a specific ID, like a Microsoft.com or a Live.com ID. And so once I'm into the system, you'll notice that I actually don't have access to any services. All I can do is maintain my account, and that's it. Right? But now it's not yet fun. I need to actually be able to use services in my system. So I'm going to go acquire a subscription. So I go to add a subscription. Now this is the only plan that was made public. And so I can see it. What this capability actually allows you to do is if you added an advertisement as part of your plan, that would show up here as well. And you have a point of integration with your billing system that will allow you to show a price of a plan as well. And we'll talk a little bit about that later in the module. So the person hits OK, and now what this is doing behind the scenes is that fan out process that we talked about. It's really generated that generating that subscription, as well as fanning out that quota limits to the different RPs. Okay. So now you can actually see that initially I had nothing, no services that I could use. But now I actually have websites, VMs, networks, SQL, and MySQL that were available to me as part of my plan. The next piece, though, is I'm going to look into my account. Let me look at my subscription and look at the services and look at how much quota I got as part of these different services. So one thing I'll notice is that I have obviously provisioned 0 virtual machines because I just created the account, but I have 100 virtual machines and that is my quota limit as part of that plan. What I'll do now is I'll add an add-on into the system. I have access to the only public add-on and I hit OK. And once I get an add-on, what this is going to do is fan out that additional quota that was available as part of that add-on back into the system. And so you'll notice that no more new services got added because this was simply an add-on. So it was only a quota extension. And now I can see subscriptions, drill down. And when I look at this, I'll be able to see that change in the allowance limit from 100 virtual machines to 110 virtual machines, because that was a capacity enhancement that was in my add-on. Okay, I'm gonna actually switch back to the slides.
All right, so as we do that, we have added another poll, if you could please answer that. And we're actually trying to gauge the average number of tenants that people have. So if you could please minimize from full screen, let us know whether you have less than 5 to 10. And we kind of broken it down all the way up to people that have over 100 tenants. So please share this information. Some of these polls we make public. Some of these we keep internal, because this is actually great data for us. So as we as the engineering team try to make decisions, we do get influenced by this type of information. So please share your feedback with us.
Yeah, that would be awesome. The next thing we're going to talk about is usage integration with subscriptions, and what it means to really integrate with the usage system, and how the service administrator can have approvals, have controls on the system, as well as use that information for billing purposes. So we start with the simple tenant. The tenant comes in and purchases a plan. This generates a subscription. And what that does is, behind the scenes, it passes a notification to the usage system, which can then, if set up, and this is optional, but if set up, it can then pass a trigger onto the billing system. Now, if the billing adapter capability is set up accurately, what this could do is this could grab that notification and either approve or reject that transaction. So if this is set up as a blocking call, this could completely block a transaction if, say, the tenant does not have a valid credit card. And if they do, it can approve that transaction, which will go back to the stack and allow us to create that subscription and do the fan out to the different resource providers. Next up, this happens when you do the add-on purchase as well. When you acquire an add-on, this updates the existing subscription like we saw, but this also sends that same set of notifications up to the billing system for approval against that purchase of additive capacity. Now, some details around the billing integration. One piece is that what this allows you to do is actually show up the plan price or add-on price so that when the tenant is going to acquire a plan or add-on, they can actually see a live price coming in from the billing system. The next thing this allows you to do is set up those approvals that I was talking about around subscription creates and deletes and add-on creates and deletes so that the billing system can accept and reject those transactions. And to basically do this, all you need to do is set up an endpoint on the billing adapter, which can really just process these notifications that are coming from the usage system and respond accurately to those notifications, as well as that handshake can be blocking or a non-blocking call. It could be just an FYI piece of information, or it could actually do blocking based on user information on the billing system side. There are certain different ways in which we can actually do approvals within the WAP context. The first piece is the one we talked about, which is the billing adapter notification approval process. And the next two I'll mention here today, but we're actually going to go in detail about both of those capabilities in the modules tomorrow. The first one here is the SMA workflow, which can actually get triggered as part of the SPF extensibility capability, which is available in IaaS, which just means that if a subscription has SPF in it or VMs in it, this really allows you to trigger workflows using SMA that will allow you to do some behind-the-scenes approvals on different services that are part of the system.
Let me just jump in, because we saw a question earlier when we referenced SMA. SMA stands for Service Management Automation. Mm-hmm. It's going to be the first module of the day tomorrow, but it's essentially our way to automate data center tasks using PowerShell workflows. So Service Management Automation, SMA, more on that tomorrow. Thanks. Yeah.
Absolutely. And so SMA and SPF have this deep link that allows you to tie in the triggers that you can have based on actions that are done against SPF. And so that is a really powerful capability. And the third piece is you can really do these approvals through a custom resource provider of sorts. And this is an example of this is the GridPro integration with Service Manager, where it takes Service Manager, which has the standard approvals process and workflow process, and just integrates that capability into WAP via a custom RP. We'll have more about that example tomorrow as well.
Now, we did have one question that came up here. Is billing done with credit cards? I don't think that that's something that WAP handles directly, but could you kind of clarify that? Because I think they're thinking of like the Azure subscription model where you have to sign up with a credit card.
Absolutely. So the key thing about WAP and the way we've designed this is actually we've tried very hard to stay away from specific business models or specific ways in which people will want to charge or not charge for their offerings. And so if you want a model where you're just offering something up to your IT department and from your IT department and you don't really want to charge anyone for it, you don't have to do any of this. If you're a provider and you're really charging for your services, you can go ahead and do that billing system integration piece. WAP does not offer a billing system out of box at all. What we offer you is a ton of data that you could use to plug into your billing system, as well as enable the right kind of billing models that you want as part of your offering. Okay. Some of those considerations, actually, this is a great segue into the business model considerations. And so the first piece that we think about is differentiation. The differentiation capability really allows you to have different sets of plans and add-ons to cater to specific customer needs. So based on your end self-service user customer needs, you want to change up the way that you add services or quotas into the system. The second piece is you want to really differentiate the way you offer infrastructure to the dev and production services. And so you can offer up different quotas as well as different underlying infrastructure using the plan capability to bundle up the infrastructure for dev and production, and people can get different subscriptions into these two and essentially move once they move from dev to production environments. The third piece is about if you essentially have a department or a particular customer who is a very large organization, you can keep their plan completely separate from whoever else is a part of that you're offering to. And this really means that you can have premium infrastructure as well as premium plans for the specific large accounts. The next piece is about monetization and chargeback. And so, if you care about how are you going to charge using plans or add-ons, you think about free trials as well as paid services. So this allows you separations between plans, as well as if you have different hardware, software, and performance tiers, you could separate those. And locations is a very important concept, where if you need to offer up different kind of capacity for different locations in the world, then you can have different billing models through different plans, so you can track that subscription very clearly to a particular location. The other aspect is really add-ons and how you can use add-ons in the system. Add-ons really bring in value-added services into the system. And so with the plan and add-on, you can actually have the right kind of mix that works for you. You could either have a plan that has a lot of services in it already and has a lot of capacity, and add-ons is just very small additive capacity, or you could have a plan that just has a set of services in it with no capacity, but really have all your monetization done through enabling add-ons and add-ons being added into the system or purchased by the tenant.
Great. So how does somebody actually track usage? How do we handle that?
Great question. So within our system, what we have is we have a different sets of resource providers that we talked about. And what the usage collector does is it's the central infrastructure piece that really interacts with these different resource providers that are in the system. So as long as you've plugged in an RP into the system, the usage collector knows all the live resource providers and goes in a circular mode and just goes and collects usage information from each of these services. And what this allows you to do is, whether it's an out-of-box service or a third-party service, it allows you to pass this sort of consumption information regarding a particular subscription and a particular resource within that subscription. So subscription one and VM one consumed so much bandwidth. That's the level of detail that you actually have in the system. And that gets passed through our usage pipeline and goes all the way out to either an analytics service, if that's what you want to enable in the system, or a billing system. And so one key thing here, though, is the usage database here is really primarily holding this data for billing purposes. And so it kind of holds it by default for about 40 days. That's extensible. It's configurable. But do not think of this as a data warehouse. This is not what that database's primary function is. You will need to pull that data out into an analytics service like service reporting, which allows you to hold that data in a sort of a data warehouse to build cubes on top of it, as well as do reporting on top of that data over large periods of time, like a year or 3 years. Now, billing service is another very important consumer of that data. And so you could do both usage-based billing, where you get a list of this consumption against a subscription and bill against that, or you could use that previous model that I talked about, which is about charging for a plan or an add-on and really doing the approval process around that and charging upfront rather than later. The next piece, a small segment, which really talks about the details of how VM clouds enables usage information. And this is really about how VMM grabs this information and pumps that information into OM. So OM is really our core store for the IaaS metering information, and SPF exposes that OM data all the way up through WAP, through the usage system that is made available to a billing system in exactly the same manner as that data is available for the different resource providers in the system. This takes a little bit of setting up. You need to be a little cautious as to the right interaction patterns while setting up the usage metering aspect. One quick slide on PowerShell. We have administrative capability that's available through PowerShell. This is actually a question that was sent in by somebody before the session. We have administrative as well as tenant PowerShell. The administrative PowerShell allows you to do all management functions of admin resources. So this is really hitting your admin and tenant API as well. for being able to do tenant-like capabilities. This uses claims-based auth, exactly the same as the portals, and it's available by default when you install WAP. This allows you to do service management, so you could use PowerShell for plan, add-on management, you could use it for tenant and subscription management, as well as there are different modules that are available to the RPs that allow RP management via PowerShell as well. The tenant capability is really looking at this from a tenant lens, which we'll talk a lot more about tomorrow. But the tenant PowerShell really, it's a cert-based authentication, which allows you to connect into a tenant public API. And this is available online. And this is the same as the Azure SDK, and it's available open source. This allows you to do different resource management. And so as a tenant, once I come into the portal and I get access to a subscription, I can then use that subscription and the right uploaded certificate to hit the tenant public API to do management of the tenant resources, like a tenant VM or website or SQL.
Excellent. Well, I think that kind of wraps up what we're discussing with you, right?
Absolutely.
So thank you so much for joining us. We're actually going to go and do a quick swap. And we're then going to move on and have John come back for us during the last part. Now, while we're doing our swap here, I just wanted to bring up a question that I've now seen a few times, and it actually came up again as we were talking about the usage metering. And that's, how do I actually do monitoring of the virtual machines themselves? Is there something within WAP that allows me to do that? The answer is directly no. What you really want to think about if you're actually monitoring the performance or the applications within the virtual machine is using Operations Manager. Now remember, if you get a System Center 2012 license, you get all of these different components within it, including Operations Manager. So essentially, what you would do within Operations Manager is configure monitoring for each of those discrete services or roles. So you would set up monitoring for Virtual Machine Manager. You would set up monitoring for your IIS server, for your RESTful website and interface. And through that, you can actually create what is called a distributed application within Operations Manager that basically allows you to say, hey, here's all of my different pieces of the puzzle. Monitor this as an end-to-end solution. Because sometimes we have these dependencies where if one piece of the solution goes down, is unavailable, it's not going to work. So Operations Manager is going to be kind of your key thing there. Now, there are also other types of analysis that we can do on that solution. The next is using that System Center Advisor utility that I talked about earlier. Now remember, System Center Advisor, this is that free cloud service, www.systemcenteradvisor.com, and it's essentially a best practice analyzer running in the cloud. What it will do is it will actually look at that full WAP implementation you have, all of your physical servers, all of your virtual machines, and tell you if you're not following best practices for configuration. Now with that, John, are you ready to kick it off and wrap us up here?
Ready to take us out today.
Yeah. Let's do it.
Okay, so just a couple of quick follow-up points to some of the content that you just got from Vibeva. And I wanted to drill in very briefly on a few IaaS administrative concepts. The first is something I talked about a little bit earlier this morning, where you have this notion of fabric underneath the interface to System Center, which is Service Provider Foundation. And in this particular case, you see a situation where you have three different VMM servers or stamps, and they're sitting behind that SPF interface that the WAP portal and API talk to. If you think about how the tenants access this stuff, you know, it can be a lot of different departmental allocations within the tenancy, and they can pretty much cross each other all over the place. And the idea of this whole metaphor or picture, I guess, is to get you to feel comfortable with the idea that we do a good job of maintaining tenant isolation. In other words, it shouldn't necessarily lead people to feel any lack of trust in the idea that a tenant from tenant A and tenant B can be living in the same cloud. Now, obviously, those clouds can be backed by the same resources, and so there's certainly the possibility of the noisy neighbor scenario. But generally speaking, the isolation that we provide is very tight, and we, you know, even within your own tenancy, you have to be very explicitly granted access to something before you can use it. So the idea that you could get access to somebody else's assets is pretty far-fetched. I'm going to talk really quickly about the configuration for WAP, which again we've already kind of gone through. The idea is, again, you figure out what your VMM allocation is and you set that up. You create the SPF interface across the top, and then above that is all the WAP assets. And then this whole session for the last hour, we've talked primarily about steps 5 and 6, where you configure offers and the tenants come in and subscribe and interact with that stuff. This is a review slide, which I won't spend more than a minute on. Just I wanted to highlight again the fact that there's this concept of a templated scalable tier workload definition in the form of this thing we call the machine role. And Andrew already talked a lot about the different constituent parts of a VM role, so I won't go into any detail there. This is only important because I'm going to show you a couple things about VM role in the portal in just a second. I kind of wanted to quickly refresh you on the concepts. One other thing that we talked about earlier, Vaibhava introduced this notion that this service administrative role has essentially four areas of focus, and she quickly talked about how they care about users, they care about their offers, they talk about usage, or the flip side of that being capacity, and then finally efficiency. And in the efficiency space, we have this notion where events that occur in the SPF layer that talks to System Center can then trigger automation to do interesting things. And initially, we conceived this as an extensibility mechanism. In fact, you heard Vaibhava refer to it as an extensibility mechanism. Later, it became much more obvious to us and important, in fact, that automation as an efficiency thing, getting back to that area of focus as a service administrator, efficiency is everything. If you're a successful service provider, regardless of whether that's public hoster or private enterprise, there's not going to be a large number of administrative people helping out to provision and maintain this environment. In fact, you could envision a team of 3 to 6 service administrators potentially supporting thousands of subscribers. And so you'd imagine that being able to scale that role efficiently is critical. And that's why this integration came up with service management automation. And the basic idea here is that anytime anything happens in the WAP portal or through the WAP API, that stuff passes through SPF if it's an IaaS request, and everything that SPF does can then be linked to a piece of automation that can do interesting things. In this particular picture, I've got both the update and the generate of the subscription mapped to what we call SPF events, for lack of a better term, and in turn those trigger these automation runbooks that will go and do other interesting stuff. Some of the examples I typically cite here are somebody who was in your opportunity CRM database went and registered with your portal. Well, at that moment, they've stopped being an opportunity and now they're a customer. So you probably want to do a call out to your CRM system and update their record to indicate that change of status. That's kind of a businessy example. One of the more infrastructural examples might be that you, every time somebody creates a virtual machine, you happen to be running System Center Data Protection Manager as a protection mechanism for those virtual machines. And in those situations, every VM needs to be added to a protection group. And so you might use something like this automation trigger to go do that once a VM is created. All right, so I'm going to quickly pop into a demo a couple things, and then that'll take us out. So let's
now while you switch over, I'll just follow up on the last poll that we've asked, which is about how many tenants do you support in your environment. And we saw kind of pretty divergent results. We have about 25% supporting 50 or more on the high end, and about 40% supporting 5 or less. So we really see kind of some big diversity here with people having, you know, 5 or less clients and then people having 50 or more. So great data. Thanks for sharing that. Back to you, John.
Cool. Thanks, Simon. Okay, so now I'm back in the administrative portal where Vaibhava spent a bunch of demo time a bit ago, and I'm actually at the moment still on the plan screen. Before I dive into that, I want to talk really quickly about how a resource provider shows up. Vaibhava talked about the fact that anybody can essentially register themselves as a resource provider on the condition that they have resources to offer and they write a RESTful interface that can plug into the WAP portal. And when you see System Center surface in this environment, you see two main things, and I'll just highlight them here. Virtual machine clouds is what you might think of as the core of virtual machine managers, virtualization, and cloud capabilities. And then the other System Center asset that shows up here prominently is the automation mechanism. I won't steal Joe's thunder because Joe Levy's going to join us tomorrow and do a deep dive on automation. And I'm going to go ahead and talk a little bit more about virtual machine clouds. But first, let's go back to this plan that Vaibhava created called, wrong mouse button there. Where is it? MVA, which one was it? That one. MVA Jumpstart Plan, that one. Yeah, that's the only one that's public right now. So let's go in and take a little closer look at this thing. She already talked about how each of the types of services that show up in this plan are listed here. And if I go into the infrastructure as a service or virtual machine clouds item, you see the stuff that Vaibhava talked about earlier, the way that any given plan for an IaaS component has an affinity to a particular VMM server, and in that context, any of the clouds on that server. And she talked a little bit about quotas. I want to highlight a couple things that maybe she didn't go into too deeply, starting with this thing around virtual networks. You could kind of see that the quota system is really set up for compute, storage, and networking, and you have some ability to control that stuff. We give pretty good fine-grained control over virtual networking to some extent. We let you have however many virtual networks you may need to use within your tenancy. But we also then allow the plan author, the service admin, to do things like throttle traffic in and out in the case of site-to-site traffic that's flowing through a gateway. And so you can imagine that the admin might use this to make sure that people always have a good responsive experience. Now, something we didn't do anything of in the previous demo was show how you can add and push networks into people's plan. So I might actually choose to go ahead and take these two networks that I offer to everybody, and I put them in every plan as just a basic service that I offer. And of course, I can take any networks out. So now I'm going to go through what will start to look like a bunch of different content in this plan that we didn't really talk about. Hardware profiles are an old school VMM concept. The idea here, I mean, the notion's not at all unusual. It's in pretty much every hosted provider you find, this notion of machine sizes. And you can see that I have a couple of machine sizes here, and I can say, okay, I'm going to make all of these available because why not? Remember, part of what I'm trying to do here is make this a compelling offer. And it sort of depends on your monetization strategy, whether the plan has richness or the add-on does, and that's kind of up to you to figure out. Another thing that shows up here is virtual machine templates. And these are standalone, what you might think of again as VMM classics templates. And this is really important because ultimately a plan or a subscription for the tenant is really only as valuable as the content that they can work with. And good starting point templates are a big part of that. So I can select templates and put these in the plan. Now I want to show you that gallery item shows up here. So at the same time that I can define standalone VM templates, I can also pull in these VM roles that are defined as gallery items, what we call gallery items. And I can decide whichever ones of these I want to pick. And I can go ahead and assign these to the plan. So you can see that I'm basically just building out content on this thing. Oopsie, sorry, hang on one second. There we go. And then the last two things I want to show you in the plan for an IaaS, the constituent IaaS parts of a plan, are these additional settings that we make available. These things are really, it's important to know that these are not going to surface any usability differentiation in the portal itself. These are intended, you might think of it as for the high-powered PowerShell or API user. So tenants, when they deploy VMs through the WAP portal, they can then hit that VM directly using any number of mechanisms. PowerShell, if they want to write programming against it, they can do that. And we expose some of the more advanced VMM capabilities. So I can do things like say, okay, I want to let people create, view, and restore checkpoints. One of the most important things I want to show you here is this thing called Console Connector. I guess that's the short tag name for it. It's a way that we can get access to any VM, even if that VM has no networking card in the host. Well, the host has to have a networking card. The VM has to have no networking configured in order for us to be able to allow console connection to it. And that's a really cool thing. In fact, the first couple times we demoed this, we got big standing ovation on the fact that people no longer had to get a parka jacket on and go into the data center. Even if the thing didn't have virtual networking set up, we could still get to it through this console connection. That's pretty cool. And then the last thing here is we left this little wildcard space at the bottom. We call it custom settings. And you can do any number of things you want to type in here, whatever you might need to key off of if you're going to trigger automation. So imagine I'm creating this plan. I want to trigger off of anybody's VM creation against this plan. And then the reason I want to do that is I want to run a job that's going to decide whether or not the VM that just got created is going to be part of a data protection group like I talked about earlier. Well, one way I can do that is I can set tags that will allow me to key off of the values inside the logic of that automation that I'm going to run. And so that would let me do targeted things, like I might only do data protection for certain gold plan members and not others, or I might only have one customer that gets this particular managed service that I want to offer. So I can kind of do some of that stuff. We're running out of time here, so I got to move kind of quickly. I'm going to go ahead and discard those changes just because it's not super critical that I do anything with it. Let's go out to VM clouds real quick. There are a couple of things I want to show you. The administrator has the ability to query for virtual machines that have been deployed, and this is important largely as a debug process. Uh-oh, looks like we've got a frozen UI there. You could imagine me as a service administrator, I get a phone call from a tenant and they say, hey, my VM's not responding, can you take a look at it for me? So I come over here and I either search by VM name or I search by the name of the tenant and I can dig in and maybe help them see what the problem is. At a minimum, I can facilitate a conversation between the fabric administrator and this end user who may or may not even be able to speak the same language. I have the same power over virtual networks. I can come in and search on the virtual networks that have been deployed, and again, some of the same filtering ability for me to zero in on the thing. The last two, probably the most important things I got to show you in the 90 seconds I have left, is the automation step here, where you can actually connect a piece of automation to a runbook. The way you do that is you say, I want to add a mapping. When you add a mapping, you pick which thing you're going to map to. Like, let's say I want to key off of subscription. And I want to do it anytime a subscription gets created. I'm going to go ahead and run a runbook that says, say hello to these people, because we want to welcome them to our environment, send them a welcome package, give them a few URLs and other links they might find useful. And you can see thereby I've created this mapping that sets up automation anytime something that I think is important is available. Now, the last thing I want to show you is the gallery. I believe Andrew showed this a little bit this morning. I want to show you just one thing that can happen. You can imagine I've created 50 or 100 plans, and then tomorrow or even today I've gone and I've uploaded a new gallery item. Well, I don't really want to have to go edit 100 plans, and so we did think a little bit ahead to the idea that you could take a gallery item you've just uploaded and push it into other plans. And you can say, okay, you know what, I forgot to put it in these three plans, I'm going to go ahead and do that. Oops, so let's, and then that will take that and it'll go out and update those plans with access to this gallery item. And I believe that is it. I do have one last thing to finish up with. Vaibhav talked a little bit about usage. I did want to show you that we have some lightweight information about the usage of your services here. And this is important to keep in mind. If you're going to go create a new plan, don't create it in the saturated cloud. And so you can drill into these clouds and say, you know, say, how's it going out there in the gold cloud? Are people swallowing this thing up? Is it got room to give? And so you kind of are planful, I guess, as you create your plans. And I think that's it.
All right, great. Well, we'll switch back now as we're just about to wrap up the session. So to summarize what we've covered today, you know, we really tried to provide this end-to-end setup options before we start delivering advanced services. So we talked about kind of our planning and design goals around Windows Azure Pack. We talked about how we actually configure it, set it up, how we integrate it with the fabric, and then this section, how we go and provide plans and start to inject self-service. Well, with that, John, I want to thank you for joining us twice.
Thank you.
I want to thank all of our viewers for joining us today. We now have part two starting at the same time tomorrow, and we'll have a four-hour session again. We're going to start by looking at automation, then move on to third-party experiences, and finally wrap it up with some end-user tenant experiences. So come back tomorrow at the same time. Last but not least, please go ahead and complete this final poll. This is the most important one for the day for us, because this is your satisfaction about the event. But if you didn't like it, you don't have to complete the poll. We'll say that's optional. So give us good feedback, and we'll be back tomorrow. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks, everybody.